are Dr. Liana Gaidezes, who is the head of the International Bund Project Greenbelt since 1998 with a background in zoology and ecology networks. And Melanie Kreutz, who has a background in landscape architecture. She realized various national and international projects along the Greenbelt Germany and Europe, working with Bund since 2003. Dr. Liana Gaidezes is going to present the transformation process of the former border strip along the former Iron Curtain into an ecology network after the fall of the wall, as well as the Bund's commitment to the nomination of the European Greenbelt as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Melanie Kreutz afterwards is going to talk about the Greenbelt as a memorial landscape that, as she says, can only be understood in the triad of nature, culture, and history. She presents the commitment of Bund to make memorial sites in the Greenbelt continuously visible. I welcome now Dr. Liana Gaidezes. Hello. Do you hear me? There's still one problem with the sound. One moment.
Does it I need to speak.
Yes, yeah, now it's perfect. I can hear you clearly. Thank you.
You can hear me.
Yes, welcome.
Great, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for the nice introduction. As you already told the audience, I will give you an overview of the European Greenbelt, its development with the last years, and its achievement, challenges, and opportunities. My presentation is running?
It's coming up now. One moment. Yeah.
Great. Thanks. Everything perfect. Okay. The European Greenbelt, the area along the former Iron Curtain, which divided Europe over a period of almost
four decades. One moment, Mrs. Gaidezes. There's one problem with the direct streaming here on the stage. Gonna fix it shortly. Mm-hmm. Yes, now we can see it. Now you can start. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, the former Iron Curtain, which divided Europe over a period of almost four decades, was for a long time virtually untouched by human hand. And consequently, many habitats and near natural landscapes have been preserved in numerous regions along today's Green Belt. Next slide, please. Great. So the European Green Belt has many origins. Already in the 1970s, the value of the borderline became obvious. A first transboundary nature conservation cooperation between Finland and the Soviet Union on governmental level started, and also first surveys of endangered breeding bird species along the inner German border was conducted by BUND, by Friends of the Earth Germany. And here on the picture above, you see the symbol bird of the inner German Greenbelt, a vinchet on a former border post of the former GDR. And that was also one of the surveyed species. And only a few weeks after the fall of the Iron Curtain, BUND initiated the Greenbelt Germany project in December 1989, so just a few weeks after the fall of the Iron Curtain. So in the early 1990s, important transboundary conservation areas were established along the European Greenbelt, like, for example, the very famous and big national park Neusiedler See, Förte Hanschak, at the Austrian-Hungarian Greenbelt. First activity started also, not the next slide, please. Back. Back. Uh, Okay, that's no. Yes, no. Yeah, here we are. Okay, here along the Austrian-Hungarian Green Belt. And first activity started also in the Balkan region by an NGO called UNATURE, which is two-day regional coordinator of the Balkan Green Belt. And between 1992 and 1994, another milestone for the Fennoscandian Green Belt was implemented, the inventory of very unique border forests. Next slide, please. Oops, that's the wrong direction. Okay, great. So the European Green Belt runs from the Barents Sea high in the north at the Norwegian-Russian border to the Black Sea, the Bulgarian-Turkish border, and to the other side to the Adriatic Sea, spanning 9 distinct biogeographical regions and 24 countries in Europe, so quite a long route. And along the 12,500 kilometers, it connects wilderness areas, cultural landscapes, water ecosystems, coasts, and large woodlands. So you can imagine that the Green Belt links climatic and vegetation zones and provides an important refuge and migration corridor for numerous endangered animal and plant species, and contributes to the protection and development of biodiversity in Europe. And about 47% of the European Green Belt area is already protected. And also an example, maybe in the Green Belt Germany alone, we have more than 1,200 endangered species. Next slide, please. Great, thank you. So here you can see there are as many as 49 national parks alone directly along the European Green Belt, and 19 of which are cross-border, so really cross-border protected areas. And there are more than 1,100 protected areas in general in a corridor of 1 kilometer along the European Green Belt. So today, the Green Belt is really an ecological network of global significance and of strong importance for the long-term preservation of Europe's unique ecosystems and biodiversity. Next slide, please. Because just in this very difficult times, it's also very difficult to travel abroad. And so now I show you only some impressions of the European Green Belt, of the very unique landscape. We make a little fly from high in the north, from the Green Belt, Fennoscandia. Here you can see the beautiful Kitka River. Next slide, please. To the Baltic coast here in Estonia, because we have the Baltic Sea and all the Baltic states there on the Baltic Sea, very unique areas. Next slide, please. To the typical picture of the inner German Green Belt. Here you see the really habitat connecting system, the ecological corridor in the intensive agricultural land in Germany. Next slide, please. To a very nice area also in the Central European region, here a Triglav National Park in Slovenia. And last impression of the European Green Belt from the Balkan region. Next slide, please. You can see that's the iron gate at the Danube between Romania and Serbia. So it's really a wonderful area. It's really worthwhile to visit. Next slide, please. So how did the European Green Belt initiative start? So in June 2002, Mikhail Gorbachev, I think the most of you heard about him, it was a former president of the Soviet Union, visited the Green Belt Germany. he came to celebrate a land art project by a BUND, the so-called West Eastern Gateway. It's in the region Eisfeld in Thuringia, in northern Thuringia in Germany. And here BUND for the first time announced the idea of a green belt, not only through Germany, but also through Europe. And so the European Green Belt project was born as a pan-European ecological network and an outstanding memorial landscape. And shortly after, in 2003 and 2004, the idea was taken further together with the German Federal Agency for Nature Conservation and with IUCN, the International Union for Conservation of Nature. And during a conference in 2004, really concrete decisions on direct actions for the implementation of the European Green Belt, on the institutional structure, on stakeholder participation, as well as on enabling activities were taken. So the plans for a pan-European initiative received really strong political support, and the decision for the establishment of the initiative was made. So on the right side, you see the European Green Belt. It's divided in four main regions, and the regions are managed by so-called regional coordinators. So we have the Sveno-Scandinavian Green Belt, the Baltic Green Belt, the Central European Green Belt, and the Balkan Green Belt section. And moreover, every neighboring country has a counterpart, mostly from a governmental organization, for the Green Belt, the so-called national focal points. And today, around 150 organizations, NGOs and GOs are involved in the initiative. So in May 2013, there was a big success because the EU Commission named the European Green Belt Initiative as one of the few examples of green infrastructure realized at the European level. And we had also very good political support, thanks to the Joint Declaration of Intent. That's an official pledge to support the European Green Belt, signed by governmental organizations, mostly from environment ministries. So, and it's always pointed out that it is not only an ecological corridor, it is a unique landscape of remembrance, a memorial landscape, and a cultural and natural heritage. Next slide, please. So here, the European Green Belt Initiative has a very special vision. The European Green Belt, our shared natural heritage along the line of the former Iron Curtain, is to be conserved and restored to function as an ecological network connecting high-value natural and cultural landscapes whilst respecting the economic, social, and cultural needs of the local communities. So that's very important to also convince the local people of the idea and of the European Green Belt. Next slide, please. So here only a very special slide. I only wanted to show you that in the European Green Belt Initiative, we have really special different layers to work with the different stakeholders, from a layer of meaning, from the special layer, from geopolitical layer. So you need really a very good interdisciplinary work. Next slide, please. And until 2010, I already mentioned IUCN, was responsible for the coordination of this really big and ambitious initiative of the European Green Belt, but IUCN was not able to fulfill this coordination anymore. So consequently, a new organization has to be founded for coordinating the initiative. And so in September 2014, we founded the European Green Belt Association, and you can see here the founding members, and currently we have 31 members from GOs and NGOs from 16 countries in this association, and now we have a mandate with the association to coordinate this really ambitious project and initiative. Next slide, please. So the mission of the European Green Belt Association is to ensure that the European Green Belt is efficiently protected and that its sustainable development is promoted by facilitating an ongoing coordinated transboundary cooperation at all level and across all sectors of society. And if you're interested, we also have a European Green Belt newsletter several times a year. Please contact this email address. Next slide, please. And as you can imagine, together with our partners, we are implementing transnational and cross-border cooperation and projects in always in the contact nature, culture and history. And of course, the European Green Belt Initiative requires funding that does not stop at national borders. So we were already, it was already possible to have some really transnational project along the European Green Belt, mostly funded by the EU Commission. Next slide, please. So, but now some brand new informations. The vision of the European Green Belt to be nominated as UNESCO World Heritage Site, that's not brand new, that now we are talking about for the last 10 or 11 years. But next slide, please. We have now really the opportunity to that our vision will come true. Next slide, please. Thank you. because one German country, it's Thuringia, they took now the initiative, and we try now to nominate the German Green Belt on the German tentative list for World Heritage Site. That's now one of our main tasks as BUND Department Green Belt to really to fulfill our dream that, for example, for the first country of the European Green Belt will be on a tentative list for the World Heritage Site. So next slide, please. Then here you can see the UNESCO World Heritage Sites on nature and culture. That's only 39 sites in the world are mixed sites. And here the green line in the slide, that's the European Green Belt. So I think that would be really a unique ecological corridor in the world as a mixed site for nature and culture. And as you can see here also in the Korean Peninsula has no mixed sites on World Heritage Sites. So I think probably also the DMZ would be a very good vision for a World Heritage Site. So finally, next slide, please. I do not want to end without pointing out that there are many parallels, as already Bernhard Seliger in the morning told us, between the Green Belt in Germany and also in Europe and the DMZ in Korea. We have a lot of same images and visions you can see here from Death Zone to Lifeline, Memorial Landscape. Also in Korea, they thought about World Heritage listing, and it's a Cold War heritage. So I hope we can further cooperate with the Korean DMZ to get our dreams fulfilled. So the last slide, please. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you want to have a closer look to the project European Green Belt and also Inner German Green Belt, that's the website addresses. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gaidesis. That was a very interesting insight. We're going to switch now directly to your colleague, Melanie Kreutz. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, Melanie Kreutz. Nice to meet you here. Is the audio working? One moment. Can you say something? Not yet. I think the technicians are on it right now. I think that it must be possible that you're still muted in the program. Can you check this? Or if you just refresh the page, maybe that's going to help.
Is it working now?
Ah, yeah. There you are.
Okay, fine. Okay.
So, welcome to the symposium, Ecological Thinking in Border Zones.
Yes.
Looking forward to your speech.
Yeah, but now I have the problem. I'm not able to go back to Zoom. So,
for the slide?
Yes, for the slides. So the plan was that I'm switch my slides myself. Okay. So you will do it. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Okay. Perfect.
So. Okay. So yes, as Liana already said, the Green Belt is a unique memorial landscape, and it can be understood in this triad of nature, culture, and history. So only this overall view justifies also this designation as National Nature Monument, and also this new demand to nominate it as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. So next slide, please. So could you show the next slide?
There we go. Now you can.
Is the next slide already there? I can't see it.
Now it's there, yeah. Greenbelt Memorial Landscape. It's the first one. You want to see the next one?
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yes, thank you. Okay, so. So with this increasing distance to the opening of the border, so the Iron Curtain and the Berlin Wall, the importance of this memorial landscape Green Belt is really increasing, because in the meantime we have several generations in Germany who have not grown up with this border and do not have personal memories on the Iron Curtain. And so this is a symbolic picture here. These are two girls from a school class. They are visiting the Green Belt in the federal state Saxony-Anhalt, where BUND has one of its main pilot regions. And this is a typical observation post. Here at this place, it's for bird watching and watching also other animals. But of course, every time when we have such groups at the Green Belt, we also give information on the border history and on the special culture of the region. So next slide, please. So yes, the inner German border claimed numerous lives and caused also great personal suffering, because there was these inhuman destructions or fortifications of the border, which you can see here in this picture. There were destructions of whole villages and also a forced settlement of people, of thousands of people living there in this border region. And they were resettled by the GDR government from this border region to the inlands, or they had the possibility to escape to the west. So this was a really brutal and inhuman border. And in the euphoria of the fall of the Iron Curtain and the fall of the Berlin Wall, all of these places and the border fortifications were dismantled in a very unorganized manner. And so in the along the former inner German borderline, you won't see so much of these structures, or you see these structures, but for example in Berlin you won't see anything, and so it is really a huge task also for the Green Belt to preserve this memorial landscape. And this is what we do, for example, also with this brochure. It's called in German Spurensuche am grünen Band, and in English, it's the next slide, it's Traces of the Past.
One moment, Melanie. Can you please unmute your Zoom, because we have a slight echo here when we listen to you?
Okay.
There's, because you have two different sound.
Yes. but I'm not able to go in Zoom, so maybe the technician could mute me in Zoom.
Okay.
Yes, it's not working. I just can't go to Zoom anymore.
Okay, so when you're not in Zoom, then I wonder where the second layer of sound comes from.
No, I just can. I just can go to Zoom. I think I'm in Zoom currently.
I think now it's better, actually. Something. I think the technician found out. Okay, you can continue. Sorry.
Okay. So yes. I wanted to talk about this pressure. We did it together with the Borderland Museum in Teistungen, and it's available in English and German. And there in this brochure, we show what you can see today in the landscape, the relics of the Iron Curtain. And this is quite impressive because you can really see something in the landscape in along the Green Belt. Because maybe you know we have many of these borderland museums in Germany, and they preserve relics of this border at these spots where the museums are. But the Green Belt is really only the only structure which is showing the whole entity of the former border fortifications throughout Germany. Okay, so the next slide, please. Yes. And we had a project going on from 2007 to 2011, which was funded by the German Federal Agency for Nature Conservation. And this was a project which dealt with the experienced Green Belt. So the aim was to make the Green Belt available and accessible for tourists and for locals. To establish a touristic office and also to increase the regional value, like, for example, to make the regional culture better shown for people and to support local handicraft, and of course also to show the history of these regions. So the history during the Iron Curtain times, during the Cold War, and also before. And the next slide, please. Yes, we had three different model regions where this project was conducted. And this is the further north one. It's Elbe-Altmark-Wendland region. And this was lying in four different federal states. And so they developed, for example, a really famous, nowadays famous biking trail called Vierländerradweg in German. This is the four country biking trail in English. And you can see the map here in the slide from this biking trail. And throughout this biking trail, there are several points of interest where they just elaborated, the local history or local nature information, nature conservation information for the tourists. And for example, this biking tour was, or this Green Belt there was awarded as the number one holiday region by the magazine Bike and Travel. So you can see this is really a famous tourist region, also because of the Green Belt. The next slide, please. Yes, and this was another of these model regions there in the Thuringian Forest and Slate Mountains and Franconian Forest. We had some really special project because there were, for example, school classes. You can see it on the picture in the right. There's a pupil sitting and he is interviewing a contemporary witness, this old lady sitting there. And she is talking about her life in the border zone. So this was really a very interesting project because these pupils collected all these oral histories from the people which lived along the Iron Curtain. And then these stories were taken for some trails and hiking and biking trails, so-called experience trails. And when you are on this trail with your bike or hiking, you can see that in the picture below, there are some signs with a number. And when you dial this number, you can hear these stories from the contemporary witnesses and also information on nature and culture in this region. So the next slide, please. Yes, this is the map from this experience trails. You can also hear that also today at Thomas. This is a homepage where all these audio media is recorded. And you can also, you can hear that when you are on site along the Green Belt on these trails, or you can also hear these stories when you are just looking in the internet. So the next slide. Okay, yes. So now I'm coming to, a special topic, to the many different Green Belt actors, because we have many people who are active along the Green Belt, who are not co-workers, who are more or less honorary working for the Green Belt and for BUND or other organizations. And this is the example of Rainer Cornelius. He is a retired ecologist. And in his free time, he is he's elaborating books about the Green Belt. For example, he did a book series about the inner German Green Belt, which you can see here in this picture. And he describes in these books the culture and the nature of the Green Belt, but also the border history. So the border relicts and where you can see it and where to go there. So next slide, please. And we have also other initiatives, for example, from our colleague, he's called Jürgen Stark, and he, for example, he made a destructed village directly in the former Iron Curtain. He made it visible again, and he built up a memorial place for this village. It was called Jasau, and this was a quite old village, and it was raised to the ground by the GDR government because it was lying directly at the Iron Curtain. And Jürgen is also doing really nice excursions with pupils. You can see it here at the right side. There are some pupils who are doing an excursion directly in the former border zone. And they have in their hands relics of plastic landmines. And this is quite really impressive for this pupil to see these relics of this really brutal border there in the landscape. So this is... they are not harmed, of course, by these plastic relics, but they are really from plastic landmines, which were there in the soil. Next slide, please. Yes, and this is also an action by Jürgen and another honorary co-worker, Ralf and Ilka Georgi. They, have a special action, which is called Border Signs. They are signing the Green Belt with the little sign marks where you can't see so good if where the Green Belt is. So they make the former border and now the Green Belt visible again for tourists with these border signs. Next slide, please. Yes, and the Green Belt is also an really international meeting place because we have at the Green Belt Germany, but also along other places as at the European Green Belt, for example, in Czech Republic and Austria. We have since several years international youth camps. And in these youth camps, the young people, they do not only do nature conservation work, which you can see in the picture on the left side, where some young people are maintaining a hay meadow, but they also elaborate other things in the framework of this border history. They are doing art projects and they just discover also the relics of the border and they discover the history of the former Iron Curtain. Next slide. Yes, and this is also a special thing to discover the memorial landscape. This is an activity from the youth organization of BUND. They were hiking along the European Green Belt and were discovering the nature there along the Green Belt and the history. For example, at this picture on the right side, you can see some old border fortification in the Harz Mountains. but they were also at the Iron Curtain, or the former Iron Curtain, the Green Belt now in Serbia and Romania, for example. And they had a campaign on social media because they were hiking with Bundy. You can see this little animal here in the picture. This is the mascot of the Green Belt. And they had a social media campaign and always showing Bundy and the different places along the European Green Belt. Next slide, please. Yes, and what is also a big topic is to make really history visible, also to show the different persons or the personal destinies along this former border. For example, here, this is a cooperation from BUND with the Union of Victims Association of Communist Tyranny. And we did several memorial places for people who were killed at the inner German border. For example, in this video from Clemens Wilhelm in the lunch break, you saw right at the beginning a person. His name is Harry Welzin. And for example, this memorial place, which you can see in the middle at the bottom of the slide, this is the memorial place for Harry Welzin, who was killed in 1983 because he wanted to escape into the West, and he was killed by spring guns. And so this is also really a big topic to show this personal histories of this refugees who were killed at the border. So next slide, please. Yes, and this topic is also really relevant on the European level along the European Green Belt, because it's for years it was known that there were many people killed along the inner German border, but there were also many people killed along the Iron Curtain elsewhere in Europe. For example, at the border of the Czechoslovakian Republic, 282 persons were killed. And these were people, or most people from Czechoslovakia, but also from Poland, from Austria, from Germany, and also from Hungary. So this is, for example, a newspaper article from December 2017 about murders of refugees along the Iron Curtain in former Czechoslovakia and also in Bulgaria. And many of these cases are still unsolved and unpunished. But the foundation platform of European Memory and Conscience, this is also a foundation which we are working with in the framework of the European Green Belt Initiative, they brought these murder cases to court. And they are ongoing, for example, in Czech Republic. There are several of these cases ongoing. And the Czech Republic has charged some of the accused persons. And it's really important topic because, as you can remember, these families of these murdered people, they just would like to see justice, and it's also a good way to improve the transboundary and transnational relationship between states if these cases can be solved. So next slide, please. Yes, there you can see I have just two examples of memorial places along the European Green Belt. This is, for example, a famous one at the Czech-Austrian border. This is the so-called Portal to Freedom. And there you can see this is for the killed refugees. And on every of these sticks, you can see there, these metal sticks, the name of one refugee is written on these sticks. The next slide, please. And this is also a famous memorial place. This is situated at the Slovakian-Austrian border, close to Devin, or close to the capital city of Slovakia, Bratislava. And this is directly where the Morava and the Danube are converged. And here also, this is a symbol or a memorial place for the many refugees which died there because they tried to swim through the Morava and the Danube to go to the West. Yes, and this last slide, please. Yes, and with this quotation, the past cannot be changed. The future is yet in your power. I would like to end because, as you saw, the protection of nature and historical heritage belongs together in the framework of the Green Belt. By protecting nature, we also protect this memorial landscape, and by reappraisal, this history, which was often a very violent history at the Green Belt, we can secure a little bit peace and democracy for the future, because we can see and we can understand that this fatal consequences of dictatorship at the Green Belt. And I think this is really important for young people to see that and yes, to go into the right direction in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Melanie Kreutz, for this very insightful presentation. Lots of different tasks you are facing in your projects. Interesting to see. Interesting. Thank you.